Hello there and welcome. This is Point of View. I'm Mark Leishman. Now, tonight's guest is Alex Pressman, who grew up in Minnesota and began his career in industrial and pharmaceutical chemical sales. Eventually, he started his own highly successful IT company in Silicon Valley and then decided to quit that and he came to live in Nelson. After a time playing golf, got a bit bored with that and has now become an avid campaigner for the New Zealand environment. Instead, he started a company called Waikaitu, which produces an organic fertilizer made from seaweed, and it's very, very good in this battle against nitrates and soil, etc. So we're going to find out all about that as we welcome Alex to our program.
Thanks for being here. Great to be here, Mark.
Thanks for joining us. First up, let's start with the Waikaitu and tell us how you came up with the idea and what it does.
We looked at some problems in the environment at first. You know, I wanted to come up with something that we could find the problem, define it, understand it fully, find a way to solve it. And then we would like to be able to solve another problem with the products of this problem. Right. So that's what we started thinking. It was difficult to find, but we finally settled on an invasive seaweed species called Undaria pinnatifida. It's in Marlborough Sounds, actually. It's all over New Zealand, unfortunately. It came into the country in the ballast water of cargo ships back in the 80s. And has since spread everywhere. The government has spent $120 million trying to get it out of our waters with no success. They're still trying to keep it out of Milford Sound, but it's there already, so it's going to be an uphill battle.
And is it voracious? Does it grow quickly?
Yes, it's a very interesting seaweed, Mark. It starts its life as a single cell organism called a gametophyte. It floats in the water for about 8 to 9 months until it finds something to hang on to, such as a rock or a rope on the muscle lines. Right. And once it's there, it waits for water to get cold enough. So right around June or July, it suddenly springs to life and starts to grow. And by September, it's 1.3 meters long. And I have seen muscle lines and rocks that were so covered in Undaria pinnatifida that you could not actually see the muscles.
And what does it do? I mean, just strangles anything around it, pretty much.
That's right, Mark.
It
chokes the muscles. I've seen muscles completely enclosed in this root system that this plant has. It's not really a plant, and its those are not really roots, but for the sake of easier understanding, that's what it was. And so the muscles cannot breathe. And it's obviously not so good for the mussel farmers, who, when they harvest the mussels with Undaria attached, have difficulties of all kinds. First of all, they're too heavy, so the mussels sometimes fall down to the bottom, and other times they just, the Undaria pinnatifida will bind itself in machinery and will gum it up and stop them from working. It's very expensive, both from maintenance and work stoppage point of view.
From Marlborough Sounds point of view, is it throughout the sounds, or is it, you know, how do the companies, the mussel farms, etc., combat it?
It is throughout the sounds, Mark. It's everywhere now in New Zealand, from Bluff to Ringa, you know, and so it's a problem everywhere. Mussel farmers have just learned how to deal with it. They have to put up with additional costs and fuel and maintenance and labor because there is no other way right now.
So you decided this little devil needs to be used in a more productive way.
Yes.
And so how did you get onto this idea of using this weed as something more, I guess, positive?
Although it is a terrible invasive species, Mark, it is actually a very good, nutritious seaweed, one of the best seaweeds in the world for food, for human food. In Japan, they use 200,000 tons of this seaweed for food, and many people in New Zealand have eaten it without realizing they were eating it. So if they ever had a cup of miso soup, the green seaweed in the miso soup is the same seaweed that we have invading our waters. And those little sushi salads, you know, the stringy with sesame seeds on them, those are also wakame, is commonly known. Yeah. Right? So on one hand, it's terrible for our environment. On the other hand, it's a wonderful source of food and fertilizer for our soil. And you know, so it can be a good thing.
Is your company, Waikaitu, the only one harvesting it?
We are the biggest harvester of wakame in New Zealand at this time.
Seems like it's
there should be a lot more people doing this if it's so abundant.
Yes, that's what I thought. The first thing I thought was, why isn't everybody doing this? Why is it a problem? This is a great opportunity. So that's why I started the company. And it's been going up and up ever since, yeah.
And, you know, so you produce the product. Tell us about this product and its relationship to trying to stop this nitrate issue.
Yes. We have a serious problem with nitrates in New Zealand. According to Statistics New Zealand, 143,000 tons of nitrates are leaching into our soil every year. That is equivalent to rendering 3.17 trillion liters of fresh water undrinkable every year. These are huge numbers, and the only thing that makes it even worse is that I don't believe that it goes far enough. Mm-hmm. Statistics New Zealand says that they think that 7% of fertilizer is being leached into our waters. Mm-hmm. But fertilizer efficiency is only 50%. Mm-hmm. Of course, some of it goes up into the air, and that becomes nitric oxide, which is basically smog. Mm-hmm. And in California, for example, this smog accounts for 50% of all emissions. The cars are the other 50%.
Really? Yeah.
Right, but they have 30 million more cars than we do. Mm-hmm. So our ratio is probably much towards the agricultural emissions of greenhouse gases than automotive. So that's where we need to look at if we are really serious about combating climate change, that's one thing. And the other stuff goes into the ground, right? And it's definitely more than 7%. It's probably closer to 30 or 40% that goes into the ground. So this number of 2 trillion liters of water being polluted is probably 4 to 5 times larger.
Yes. Every year.
Every year. Yeah, these are horrendous numbers.
Now, Chief Scientist, or the Science Advisor at least, Sir Peter Gluckman, he says that the damage we're seeing in our water aquifers now is the result of nitrate use 50 years ago. So, as you point out, we're, what, 3 times that now?
Yes.
With intensification, et cetera.
Increasing the usage of nitrogen fertilizers by between 2 and 3 times since the 80s. And since the 80s, yes.
So your suggestion that it could be a lot worse than we think.
We haven't seen the worst of it.
Yeah.
The reason it takes about 30 to 50 years for nitrates that were applied to the surface to get down into the groundwater.
Now, we know it's a carcinogenic, this nitrate or environmental toxin. What else can it do damage to us?
On the cancer side, it's one of the chief causes for bowel cancer, which is already quite high prevalent in New Zealand. So we certainly don't want any more of that. For infants, it's very dangerous because they have a specific bacteria in their gut that once they drink nitrate-laden water, and it only takes 45 parts per million to be dangerous to an infant up to 3 months of age. And so when they drink it, the gut bacteria will convert that into nitrite. The nitrite will permeate through their bloodstream, will glom onto red blood cells, stopping where the oxygen binds to the red blood cells. That will turn the blood cells blue, and for the rest of their existence, they will never be able to uptake an oxygen ever again. So a child can be breathing normally and suffocate. It's called the blue baby syndrome that is a real danger.
So what does your product, what is the product called? Is it simply Waikaitu?
The product is called Nitro Boost. What Nitro Boost does is that by using Nitro Boost, we can cut use of nitrogen fertilizers by half. And it's not so strange. People say, well, okay, so you cut the fertilizers by half, so big deal, I can do that myself. Mm-hmm. But we do that without affecting yields. Mm-hmm. And what we do is we simply buffer that nitrogen, so it's not leaching into the water and it's not going up and volatilizing into the air as ammonia. And so we've been able to do some trials in California on lettuces and strawberries, and we found out that in lettuces, the farms were actually making $700 US per acre more because their lettuces were bigger, while they halved their fertilizer.
So when you say it buffers it, how does that work?
Nitrogen is that we put on, it's basically urea or ammonia,
yes.
It's quite dangerous to soil bacteria. It will burn them and kill them. Then you have a problem of not just the nitrogen leaching, but the dead bacteria are also now going into the groundwater, becoming a pollutant. Our product covers and coats that nitrogen so it doesn't burn the bacteria. They're able to hang on to it, keep it in the root area of the soil and not leach out.
You sort of suggest that the aims now are to clean up our waterways, as everyone knows about that. The headlines are there almost every day now. Who will be hit the hardest when this happens? Do you think farming is very vulnerable?
Yes, unfortunately, as we know, there's a big lack of understanding of what it takes to grow our food. There's always a desire to point fingers at people. This is not a productive way of dealing with this problem. We need to make sure that the farmers do not lose their livelihood, they're not taxed out of existence, that they don't lose their farms, or that their farms are not losing value. You know, sometimes governments declare farms as a cleanup site, a chemical cleanup site, and then it becomes impossible to sell it for either farming or any other use because the liability goes with the land. So we need to make sure that that doesn't happen. But what we also need to make sure is how do we give the farmer the ability to use less chemical fertilizer, keep their yields the same so their livelihood is not affected, and at the same time save our environment and the future of their children.
Well, we've had some of the answers. We'll have more right after the break. My guest is Alex Pressman, who's founder of Waikaitu in Nelson, and we'll find out more about Nitro Boost and what it can do right after this break. You're watching Point of View on Country TV.